I thank Malcolm for this. Malcolm never went to the roster without a few books.
Yes.
And believe me, if it wasn't for Malcolm, and I thank him with whatever differences we had,
yes,
but Malcolm encouraged us to read.
Yes, sir.
And I never heard of J.A. Rogers until I came to
that's
the monster.
Right, right.
I never, there were books that I just didn't know anything about.
That's right,
but
right.
He would always come up and he would talk about a book or two. So I'm going to do that tonight before we open up the floor. If you know that there were 104 books given to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad by the Savior to read, what did the minister say was in all of the aspect in all of those books? What did he say? And so, in other words, the Savior gave the Honorable Elijah Muhammad a study of his life.
Yeah.
And there is no prophet whose life is more detailed than the life of Prophet Muhammad. So how could you be a Muslim? Your religion of Islam, the book that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said would one day be the law of the land, is the Holy Quran, but you don't know nothing about aspects of the faith. Now, when the Savior came, the Yusuf Ali translation did not exist. Yusuf Ali's translation was done in 1934. The Mawlana Muhammad Ali was done in 1917. And he was the first Muslim to translate it into English. There's other English translations before that, and a Latin translation, even of 1143, I believe, there was a Latin translation. But all of the English translations before Mawlana Muhammad Ali, the difference was, in 1934, when the Yusuf Ali came out, they had God in it. And they had God in it all the way up until probably 1969 or 70. And then they changed it to Allah. So the Savior took the Holy Quran that he introduced us to was an Ahmadiyya Holy Quran, and this is why Imam Muhammad tried to say he was an Ahmadiyya from Pakistan instead of the holy city of Mecca that we were taught. I mean, he said it, and he even said a man named Muhammad Abdullah, who I know his two sons, was Master Farad Muhammad, who lived in California. But Master Farad Muhammad gave us this Holy Quran because, number one, the English in the Mawlana Muhammad Ali is excellent. But my point is that the Mawlana Muhammad Ali's English, because he spoke Urdu, the British ruled India, it was all India, Pakistan, didn't exist until 1947-48, so it was all India. When Imam Muhammad came in, he wanted us to stop using the Mawlana Muhammad Ali because the Saudis condemned that and they didn't want it used, so they brought in all of the Yusuf Ali Holy Quran, and my personal preference was the Mawlana Muhammad Ali, because Yusuf Ali used, he didn't have a good feel for English. Remember, he was an Indian Muslim who spoke Urdu, which is the language of Pakistan today, and much of India among the Muslims.
Okay.
He studied English, and he studied Arabic. But here's, and I'm going to give you an example. It says in the Mawlana Muhammad Ali, it says the guilty blue eye.
Yes, right, right, right. Yes,
now, being that at that time they were trying to get to the Europeans,
right,
they looked and it says blue and arrow.
Yes, that's right, sir.
But what did he change it to?
Blair.
See, because he didn't want to offend the Europeans,
right,
because that's what their target. They weren't thinking about us in America.
Right.
Their target was to try to get the Europeans to see the beauty of Islam, hoping that they could convert Europe.
Yes,
and so he changed the blue eye to blur eye. So I'm just telling you, so these are the problems that I had with Yusuf Ali. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad says a good translation, but my preference would be the Mawlana Muhammad Ali, but the outside Muslim world said we don't use that. And how Allah did it, the minister said the first book that he read on the life of Prophet Muhammad was Prophet Muhammad by Mawlana Muhammad Ali, and that book touched it. It is an excellent short book, and it gives you an overview of Prophet Muhammad's life. Now, when we were young Muslims here in New York, the minister had three ministry classes. And the orientation class that I handled in Brooklyn, I had the minister gave me the call. He said, teach him how to pray. Akbar, you know how to pray. Teach him how to pray. And he used to make them study the introduction to the Mawlana Muhammad Ali Holy Quran. Not only in the ministry class, but the brothers who came in, I can't say what the sisters' orientation was at that time. But he wanted them to be knowledgeable about aspects of Islam. And when the minister and I were in Mecca in March of 1977, there were two questions that came up. One was, the imam said that, you know, we used to say, Assalamu alaikum. And the Imam came in and said that it should be As-Salaamu Alaikum. And he was right. The prayer is As-Salaamu Alaikum. Then he said, and the answer should be Wa Alaikum As-Salaam. And then as the thing, now remember I was the Imam's assistant, but as this thing began to move, he began to make a separation. Everybody who said Wa Alaikum Salaam, they're not with me. And I know my fault when they said Wa Alaikum As-Salaam. So it became a dividing thing. So the minister and I are sitting in Mecca with three scholars. One is Dr. Ismail Faruqi. Unfortunately, I don't know, many of you may not know, he was killed in Philadelphia. He taught at Temple University, and it was a brother that killed him in his home, a black man. Terrible tragedy. He was there, the director of the Khartoum University, and another scholar. So we're sitting at a table. And so we asked him, what is more correct? Wa alaikum salam or wa alaikum as-salam? And he said, neither one is more correct than the other. They are both correct. Mm-hmm. And all three of the scholars agreed.
Right.
And I was satisfied with that because quite naturally, we were followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and that's the way he taught us.
Right.
But there was something in there to say that certain things that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us was wrong and it even went down to the Greek. You have to understand when people say, well, y'all used to fast in December, how do you answer them?
Right.
So they're challenging what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave you and they say, Staffulali, he was wrong.
Right.
But the Holy Quran says that if you are sick or on a journey, you can fast like number of days.
Yeah.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave us December because it was the shortest days.
Right.
And we were definitely sick, and we were absolutely on a journey because we were 9,000 miles away from home. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave us the right number of days to fast. And so, and he made it easy for us. But the shortest days are in December, and in 1986 when the minister called back from the Emirates and told us to fast with the entire Muslim world, and even though most of us were fasting both months in December and with the Muslim world, and eventually the minister said that we should fast with the Muslim world.
Yeah.
And so you have to be able to defend where you are as a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and let it be based in the teachings of the Holy Quran. It hurts me when we travel, and Rashad, you hear some of the brothers say, I'll stand security. They don't get in the prayer line, not because they just want to stand security, because they don't know how to pray.
Right.
And they feel a little embarrassed or awkward, and because the prayer is not that complicated.
Right.
There's no rocket science. You ain't got to have study for 5 hours. Prayer is simple. And if you what you don't know, you follow the rest who do pray. But as a Muslim, when you go among other Muslims, if you feel insecure in your Islamic knowledge, you say, well, I'm a nation of Islam. We don't do that. We do dua. You know, we just put our hands up and pray. No, you're a Muslim.
Right.
And there's just certain things that you must learn and you must study. I'm here tonight to talk about your study of your faith. And it don't mean that you becoming a Sunni. It means you becoming well-rounded as a Muslim. You can't have people talking about Islam and they talking over your head. You don't know what they're talking about because you say, well, all I know is message to the black man and how to eat to live and so forth. And that ain't for me. That's for them Sunni Muslim. I'm going to follow the Nation of Islam. That will not fly today. The whole world is studying your faith. And your faith has certain roots. The revelation to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, 1400 years ago. The whole history of him in, how many chapters in the Holy Quran? 114. How many were revealed in Mecca and how many were revealed in Medina? And why were more revealed in Mecca than in Medina? I mean, these are things that Muslims know. Where did the Muslim first turn to pray? I mentioned this on the prayer line. They first prayed to turn to where, sisters? They faced Jerusalem. And then after Prophet Muhammad went to Medina, a year and a half later, he received a revelation to pray towards where? Mecca. And the Jews were upset because they feel that they had an edge with the Muslims. But as a Muslim, you should know that, okay? I mean, you should just know it. The first Muslims that left, what country did they go to? Abyssinia. What is that country's name today? And they found a king there who accepted them. Why?
They
the Maryam. There you go. He quoted the Surah of Maryam. Go ahead, sister. And then when the Negro's king heard that, they said, they believe it because we believe. They believe in Jesus. And the Muslim found safe haven a month. This is a part of the history of Muslim that all Muslims know. And you don't have to be a scholar of Islam. You ain't got to have books every day, as many books as I buy and read. No, it's general knowledge that you as a Muslim should know.